Good evening, and welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, or Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine panoramic vision given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5, that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walks the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane. A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Thereafter, Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. He called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in this school to prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of Sistut are as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. And seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. So now we'll have a prayer by Dr. Martin Love. Our scripture lesson is Galatians, the third chapter. Our scripture reader will be Dr. Kenaway Kleinsmith. And we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good evening, class. Let us all bow in our hearts and minds for a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, thank you once again for allowing us to gather together here, and thank you for everything that you have bestowed to us and have shown us throughout eternity, throughout time, and that you continue to instill in us to have an open heart and an open mind of the things you've yet to reveal about yourself. All these things
I'm heavy burden.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, edited by A. Vitrina of the Scripture Research Association, and this was republished by Yashra Promotions. Galatians 3. O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Yashra the Messiah hath been evidently set forth as crucified among you. This only would I learn of you, received ye the Spirit by the works of law, or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain? He therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit, and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the working of the law or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed Yahweh, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that Yahweh would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the glad tidings unto Abraham, saying, In thee shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, Cursed is every one that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of Yahweh. It is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Now the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth these things shall live by them. The Messiah hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, Cursed is every one that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the nations through Yahshua the Messiah, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men, though it be out of man's but a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannulleth or addeth thereto. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not unto seeds, plural, but to thy seed, singular, which is his Messiah. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of Yahweh in his Messiah, the law which came 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect. For if the inheritance be by the law, it is no more by promise, but Yahweh gave it to Abraham by promise. Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Not a mediator is not a mediator of one, but Yahweh is one. Is the law then against the promises of Yahweh? By no means. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness which should have been by the law. But the scriptures have concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Yahshua the Messiah might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto the Messiah, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. For ye are all the children of Yahweh by faith in Yahshua the Messiah. For as many as you as have been immersed in the Messiah have put on the Messiah. There is neither Jew nor nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Yahshua the Messiah. For if ye be the Messiah's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. That was Galatians 3. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
All right, good evening once again. And good evening to all those around the world that are participating in tonight's lecture. So, okay, this Tuesday night, our workshop night, okay? And our first speaker tonight will be Dr. Will Williams.
Good evening. It's good to be here. Good to see y'all here to learn more of this great and wonderful, colossal, stupendous, panoramic vision revelation given to us by Yahweh Elohim. And it's workshop night. In workshop, we like to get into the nuts and bolts of things. You know, break it down to its component parts, put it back together, and run with it. Okay? I have been submitted a question. Yes. Someone submitted me a question. It was Alan from Connecticut. And he asks, how come Satan is asked to get together with the sons of Yahweh, first, second, or third heaven, if he is kicked out? And the references is Job 1, first chapter 6, 7, and 8. Okay? But before we get that, let me preface that bit. I have to make a small announcement first. I'm sure most of you out there have heard that California has re-shut down. Okay, and I've already gotten inquiries about our status. Okay, basically, we've gone back to what it was at the beginning of this thing in March, for the most part, because we live stream and we're a house of worship and we're considered essential. And I know what the governor's orders said, because I was confused at first myself, because I watched the governor's orders and he said everything indoors and we had to go outdoors. And so I called the contact person for the guidelines in San Bernardino, the same person I talked to the last time, and they were saying about the outdoors thing and, you know, so forth, so on. And then we did some more investigation and found out that basically we could still meet indoors as long as if we're live streaming. That's the exception, because we're live streaming. That means we could live come indoors and live stream a few of us, so that the rest of our parishioners don't have to come here. So basically, it just goes back to what it was in the beginning, where it's the same strict guidelines: face masks, social distancing, under 10, and we're. Yeah, we're getting sanitizers and we're getting what is that called? Yes, it's the head thermometer. You know where they there's a little bit. Yeah, we're getting that. We have a sign on the door, you know, and we have to limit to 10 people. And we just tell people, if you know, you don't have to come. If you have health issues or something, don't come. You know, and if you're watching us on live, you know, whether it be YouTube or Facebook, you know, you let us know you're there, just anything, shout out or whatever, we will count it as attendance, okay? All right, that's the best we could do on that, you know, but we're still going to continue on as the law allows, and so the law is allowing us to do this, okay? So, you know, so people don't jump, oh, they're indoors, and the governor said nothing indoors, the bars, the massage parlors, the everything else, the nail shops is closed. Yeah, that's true, you know, but there are exceptions, you know. It's the loopholes, you know, that you look for, right? So, you know, I just wanted to say that to clarify that if there's any confusion, because I know some people would say, well, wait a minute, the governor said nothing, you know, you guys are still, you know, well, we still in the guidelines. We're being obedient to the law. As simple as that. And through the law, we have received permission to continue on. Okay? All right. Now, to address Alan's question. Okay. I could make it as short or as long as I would like, but I want to be comprehensive and edifying at the same time. Okay? Page 14. Let's just bring it up here. Page 14. And let's get Second Corinthians 12 and 1.
So.
2 Corinthians 12 and 1. It is not expedient for me doubtless to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of Yahweh. I knew a man in the Messiah about 14 years ago, whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. Yahweh knoweth, such an one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. Yahweh knoweth, how that he was caught up unto paradise and heard unspeakable words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter.
Okay. Now, when the question was, when I read the question, it made me flashback a little bit to last year when I was in Zambia. Frank Lewis and I was entertaining a couple of Jehovah's Witnesses at one of the brethren's house, and these were some stalwart guys. I'm telling you, we were there for at least well over 2 hours, maybe three. Okay, and this was one of the things I hit one of the preachers with that scripture there about the third heaven. Okay, because maybe I had forgotten, but they had talked about in Jehovah's Witness doctrine. See, they believe that Satan, when he was cast out of heaven, in 1914, which precipitated World War I. Okay? So they had a different take on the scriptures, because it even got to the point of the argument, see, about Lucifer in the garden and their concepts and perceptions of it. Okay, because they felt like he was like going up and down. They felt like he was going up and down in heaven until 1914. Then he got kicked out. That's how they looked at it. Okay. Now, the third heaven, and this is what we say, and like I say, the third heaven. This is what I did to him. And he still ain't answered me yet. Because I had that scripture read to these guys. And I just simply asked him, okay, what's the first and second? Silence. Okay? All right? I perceived it during the course of the, you know, exchange and stuff, where their concept was. And not just theirs, but maybe even a lot of Christianity. The concept of what heaven is and stuff, and even what we say when we talk about heaven, as a geographical location or as a state or a condition, which is what it really is. Okay? But here we talk about the three heavens, first, second, third heaven. Okay? The first heaven, let me come over here. The first heaven is space. And look here, that's like the court roundabout. That's like that's Egypt. It's black. Space is black. The earth hangs like a ball in space. Okay? Then you have the atmospheric heaven. That's the firmament that surrounds the globe. Now, those two heavens are physical. They are geographical. The third heaven is spirit law, or eternity, but I prefer to say spirit law to make it more persnickety in this sense, because it's spirit law, or the third heavens, of which the first two emanate from this one. Okay? Now, we come over here. This is the angelic creation, okay? Now, we don't say heaven per se, though Dr. Kinley did say, whatever you wanted to make this out to be, fine. Whatever it was, Satan was there, there was war there, and he got kicked out of there. Whatever you think it might be, that's what Dr. Kinley said, right? All right, let's just, now look, this is in the angelic creation, or the incorporeal creation. Look, come over here. Angelic creation, physical creation. These are the two transmuted parts of Yahweh, who is pure spirit, abstract, inscrutable, incomprehensible, etc. The two immutable, the two witnesses, for that matter. I'll even go far as to say that. Okay? Here's a dotted line here. That lets you know that there's a relationship between these two creations. You know, there's a connection. You are body, soul, spirit. We can get Greek here. Soma, psyche, pneuma. Now, just as I said on the other one, I could say first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. Mm-hmm. And just like over there, the first and second heaven emanate from the third, body, soul, spirit. Your body and soul emanate from the spirit that is in the midst of you. And that's a hard thing for someone to understand. It's hard to explain that, because just like I said over there, space, atmosphere, eternity, or spirit law. Because and it's hard for some people to see that, because from where we're standing, it appears, well, I'm standing on the earth, but the atmosphere, and we're already in the atmosphere, and then if I go up above the atmosphere, then I'm into space. So people are like, well, that doesn't seem, but see, we're looking at a principle. We're looking at a pattern. The earth, just like the altar of sin sacrifice, four horns on it. And we always talk about the four corners of the earth. There's a grid on here, a grate, where they fried the animals at. You go get an atlas, and you look on it. It's a map. It's a map that has lines, good lines, lines of longitude, lines of latitude. You have the oceans. The earth is more than 70% water. And then you have the atmosphere. You see? And then you have the spirit law, because now someone would say, well, where's that at? And you would think, because it's above that, then you would think it's above the sun, moon, and stars, or beyond the galaxies, space even. You would think that. But in reality, Yahweh is hidden in the most likely spot where the man is going to look. Right in here. Right here. This is where it emanates from, here. Even in our textbook, it talks about Yahweh, it's pure spirit, right? And he's these attributes. These attributes in part took on shape and form. All right, and then this eteristic body is the creation, and then he transmuted in part into the creation, because it does say in the textbook that he manifested in the material creation and in Yahshua the Messiah. Why? Because everything that is created is imbued with this law of the Spirit. Look, this law of the Spirit is Yahweh, pure spirit. But you can't understand that in an abstract state. You can't say anything about it. You can't say whether it's light, dark, up, down, in, out, black, white, nothing. So it behooved him to come into a state that can be perceivable. This heart, which is spirit law, now it's in the anthropomorphic shape and form of a man. But this is still spirit law. Right. Now that's represented by the height. I don't want to get off on a tangent, because I want to answer this man's question. But I'm hoping I'm laying somewhat of a foundation, so that when I do throw the answer in here. I just hope it makes some sense. That's all.
Can you repeat the question?
How come Satan is asked to get together with the sons of Yahweh in the first, second, or third heaven if he is kicked out? See, the question is he's kicked out of heaven, what spot is he meeting the sons of Yahweh at if he's kicked out of heaven? That's the question he's asking. Maybe that's not clear enough. I mean, to me, I think that's what he's, all right, where is this happening at? But before I can really address, I mean, I could easily address, I could go right into the textbook and just read and just and be done in 10 minutes. But that's not edifying. See, that's just not edifying. To me, it's not. I put it like that. That's why I'm going the route that I'm going. Okay? Okay. Now, matter and spirit materialize, which means that as these attributes materialize, we say this all the time. Everything's threefold. Proton, electron, proton, neutron, electron, nucleus, nucleolus, cell body, land, sea, and air, past, present, future. You know, everything is threefold. It's a pattern. That's structure. But also, there's a priesthood. That means there's a function. Proton, neutron, electron, that's the structure of an atom. But the function of the atom are the forces within the atom. There's electromagnetic forces. There's gravitational forces. There are nuclear forces, both strong and weak. That's like that move about between the particles, just like the high priest and the low priest move about between these, you know, these articles, you know, they move about. They do their work. They follow their course. Just like in an atom, you have the electron. They're in orbits, or what they call shells, and they follow their course. You understand? That is Elohim manifested in part, not in totality, into the material creation. That's why. And this is how it was said to me when I first came to class, that Elohim is a one-man band. He's doing all the work. He's doing everything. See? And that's the difference between what, at least I hope to say, what we teach as a doctrine as opposed to what everybody else teach. Dr. Kinley tried to use in the textbook to make a stark example, which is an example of the basis of what most religions are at, what he called the new psychological religions. Meaning, mental power, positive mental attitude, like, I can think it, therefore I, you know, it becomes, and that's not it. That ain't you. That's your carnal mind. Your carnal mind don't run nothing. That's the problem. See, it's Elohim that's doing everything. It's doing the work because he's manifested into every cosmographical facet of the universe. And look, there's only two parts. There's an incorporeal and a physical, and they're both connected because one goes into the other. See? Now, the angelic or the incorporeal creation, we're looking at it according to a pattern. Okay? So here's spirit law. Alright? And Elohim is there. And look, Elohim is not alone. Because he's got the whole heavenly host surrounding him. Okay? But now here's the thing. These folks, one third was, how can I put it? I don't want to say, well, no, one third was was predestined, I don't want to say predestined, but predisposed. Maybe that's a better word if I could put it like that. Was predisposed to be negative or to be in iniquity. And all they needed was a leader, which was Lucifer. Okay, for that to happen, Elohim had to diminish himself. See, the angels were created to serve, honor, and obey right. Elohim. Right. All right? Now, when the war in heaven happened, okay, it happened because these guys, look, here's Michael and Gabriel. That should tell you something. They're right here. They're witnessing to the law. They're not witnessing of themselves. Now, they didn't know the purpose, but they knew one thing. They knew the fear of Elohim. They did know that. And you say, well, how do you know they know that? Because I got a pattern. I can go down here in Egypt. Because it's the same conditions down here. See, like Pharaoh appears all of a sudden down here in Egypt, just like Lucifer appeared up there. And just like Pharaoh here said, go out, kill the boy babies, go out and get me some more angels. But the midwives, Shipra and Pua, feared Elohim. The angels, Michael and Gabriel, feared Elohim. And they didn't. They feared Elohim. They didn't know the purpose, but they feared Elohim because they were created to obey Elohim. They were created. See, I got a pattern to look at. I got a story to look at because it's the same thing manifested in the natural that's happening up here. Now, some folks may not want to believe that scripture. Well, you know, that's okay. But I got the scripture to show it. See? Oh, here's the one that gets me. Be honest with you, it's an old controversy. I hate to even, you know, even bring it up. But it's old. Now, the scripture, I think it's the 12th chapter of Revelations. Mm-hmm. Let's read that. 12 and 7. Why not? Mm-hmm. Yes. Anybody? Revelations 12 and 7.
Eight. And there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought in his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast into the earth, and his angels was cast out with him.
All right. Now, it says, and the dragon was cast out, that old serpent who deceiveth the whole world. And see, we've learned in this class that the word world is synonymous with age. And so some folks have said, see, it says he deceived the whole world, meaning he deceived the whole age, which is this age, the creative age, the physical and the angelic. But that's not what that's saying. Because if you do the research, a good investigation using a Strong's Concordance dictionary, you will find that the word, that the Greek word, that word world is translated from is called, I can't even pronounce it, but it means the inhabited earth. It is not age. See, because I know the word age in Greek, if I remember. It's spelled aeon. But if you do the research and look up the word from which that word world is translated from, it's something else. As a matter of fact, maybe do we have the Strong's Concordance over there? Mm-hmm. Which one? This big. Ah, yep, that's the Strongest Concordance, all right. Okay, let me see, in the Greek. Mm-hmm. All right. Have to get to the Greek part. Yeah, here we go. All right. It's been so long as I've been in this. I know it starts with an O. I have to find it. It's I know. World. Should have did this the first time. Why don't you keep reading the scripture while I look for this. Revelations, where you were at?
Okay. 11. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Elohim and the power of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our Lord day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb.
Now they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, meaning to Elohim. See, who had took on, when he took on shape and form. See, that is a death world. Okay. Deceiveth the whole world. 36. Okay, 36:25. That's what I thought. Okay, 36. I'm in the Hebrew, no wonder. I'm getting old. 36:25. This is it. All right. This is the word that when you look it up, the in the Greek, it is oikumene, I guess that's how it's pronounced. And it says specifically the Roman Empire, the earth, world. Doesn't say anything about age. See, because if it was age, then it would be this word that would be translated from, which is aeon, but it's translated from this word, see, which means the earth. So he deceived the whole earth, yeah, but not the whole angelic creation. That's my humble point. See, that's my now, they were cast out. Now here, we have angelic invisibility. It just simply means this, you can't see them. They're not abstract, they're just invisible. Mm-hmm. It's a veil. All right, now coming through the veil, we have transgression here. Coming through the veil, all right, is a transition. It's a transition from angelic invisibility to incorporeal visibility. That simply means that now they can be seen in a vision. Okay? Here. This is a case of incorporeal visibility. Eve, him appearing to Eve in a vision. Incorporeal visibility. Coming from behind a veil. Okay? And then now we'll come through here, the division between invisibility and visibility. Now, of course, at this point, they're immersed in ethereal darkness. Here's the unformed earth here. And they're just waiting. Didn't we just read that scripture? Because we're there, aren't we? We didn't. 13. Back in Revelation 13, verse 12, 13.
Therefore, rejoice, ye heavens.
Next verse.
And when the dragon saw, before that?
The next verse from where he was reading.
Okay.
Because you're in the Holy Name.
And they overcame him by the blood of the
Lamb. No. The verse down. I'm sorry. The next verse down.
I didn't finish.
And
when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child.
Now, here he is. He's out here waiting for the man-child. See, he hasn't been born yet, but he's out here waiting. Okay? See? And he did. Adam was brought forth. You didn't see Satan. But then once Eve was taken out of Adam, here he come on the scene. Yeah. Why? Draw a line. Because it's the same thing in principle that he did here, going after the bride. It says M.O., going after the bride. It's the same thing. He's doing the same thing here that he did here. Okay? All right? So now once he's cast out, all right, here we got the creation. All right, the creation is being done, and he's watching it. And then he sees Adam and Eve formed, and he comes to Eve. The transgression happens. Death befalls on Adam and all mankind, and they're cast out. And then as man is multiplied across the earth, so then these demons are incarnated in the flesh. One way I like to look at it, and I'm not going to go through it all, but maybe another day in the whole thing. Since we're in Revelations, I want you to get Revelations. Revelations 8 and 7.
Revelations 8 and 7. The first angel sounded, and there fell a hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up.
All right. That happened here. I usually correlate that with the first dispensation. All right. Because the green grass represents the souls of men. And it says one third of the trees were burnt up. Why one third? Well, the trees, see, the vegetable kingdom is likened to the angelic creation. We've showed you this time and time again about the symbiosis between the plant kingdom and the animal kingdom. It's the same way here. So it says one third of the trees were burnt up, meaning one third of the angels, and all green grass was burnt up. Because these guys are, the Holy Spirit hadn't been given yet. Isaiah 40 and 6.
Yes.
Isaiah 40 and 6. The voice said, "Cry." And he said, "What shall I cry?
Mm-hmm.
All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field."
Yeah, see, all flesh is grass. See, you know, what is he talking about? Read.
"The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the Spirit of Yahweh bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass."
The people is grass. You understand that now? See, that's why John in Revelations is right. He's just echoing and confirming what Isaiah wrote.
Mm-hmm.
See? All right. Do I want anything else from there? Go ahead.
"The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our Elohim shall stand forever."
All right. See, that will stand forever. All right. Now, just to make the story shorter, this age. The age of conscience, see, and demons, you know, just incarnated in man, and they're just doing, you know, whatever. I mean, you know, they're just, Cain built his kingdom, dynasty, really. Right. Yeah, and just, they were the alpha dogs. His family was the alpha dogs of that age, all right? The city of Enoch that they built, that he built, the capital of the earth. Not only of the earth, but the capital of all wickedness that was happening on the earth in this age. So much so that Yahweh sent the flood to wipe it off. Okay? Now, give me plate 19. Okay, here we have the fountains of the deep breaking up. Matter of fact, we could probably read this. Let's read Genesis 7:11.
Genesis 7:11.
Mm-hmm.
In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up.
See, all the fountains of the great deep were broken up. Read.
And the windows of heaven were open.
And the windows of heaven were open. That's a veil. The fountains of the deep were broken up, and the windows of heaven were open. That's a rending of a veil, just like the Red Sea opened up here, which is in type the fountains of the deep breaking up, and the Jordan River opened up for the Israelites, just like the windows of heaven opened. I'm just making a comparison. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, let's get Genesis 8. I'll start with 1. Why not?
Genesis 8:1. And Elohim remembered Noah and every living thing and all the cattle that was with him in the ark.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim made a wind to pass over the earth, and the waters assuaged. The fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped,
mm-hmm.
and the rain from heaven was restrained.
Mm-hmm.
And the waters returned from off the earth continually, and after the end of the 150 days, the waters were abated. And the ark rested in the 17th month, in the 17th day of the month, upon the mountain of Ararat. And the waters decreased continually until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, were the tops of the mountains seen.
Okay, now hold it for a moment. Now, we have here, this is the antediluvian age ended by a flood. The fountains of the deep broke open, and we got to see these people floundering out here in the water. They'll be dead in a moment. So that's the death. And then they're inundated. The whole earth is inundated. Elohim immersed all flesh. So that's a death and a burial. As the waters are rising, the ark is on top of the waters. So as the waters is rising, the ark is rising, see, which is a type of resurrection. And it rained 40 days, 40 nights. But now, read 6.
6. And it came to pass at the end of 40 days,
uh-huh.
that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made. And he sent forth a raven, which went forth to and fro until the waters were dried up from off the earth.
Yeah, plate 20, please. All right. Yeah, because see, then the mountains were seen. All right. Yeah, plate 20. All right. Yeah, this is a better plate. Because see, because here I wanted to show at least the people dying, because they were incarnated right. with these satanic spirits. All right. All right. Now, here, the wicked is destroyed, which is the figure of baptism, because the earth is inundated in water, and as I said, it's the figure of a resurrection, because the ark rose above everything. Remember, as the water rose, the ark rose. And then now we just read about a raven mm-hmm. being cast out. Read that part again.
7. And he sent forth a raven, which went forth to and fro until the waters are dried up from off the earth.
All right. Went to and fro. Why? Because, see, it's echoing, draw a line, over here. Over here, because that's what they did. They were cast out here to the unformed earth, immersed in ethereal darkness, going to and fro. Draw a line. Just like as reflected here by this raven. Okay? Read on a little more.
And he sent forth a dove from him to see if the waters were abated from off the face of the ground. But the dove found no rest for the sole of her foot. And she returned unto him into the ark, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth.
Mm-hmm.
Then he put forth his hand and took her and pulled her in unto him into the ark. And he stayed yet other 7 days. And again he sent forth a dove out of the ark. And the dove came into him in the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. So Noah knew that the waters were abated from off the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And he stayed yet other 7 days, and sent forth a dove, which returned not again into him any more. And it came to pass in the 601st year, in the first month, the first day of the month, the waters were dried up from off the earth,
mm-hmm.
and Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked, and behold, the face of the ground was dry. And in the second month, on the 27th day of the month, was the earth dry.
Okay, now, this is when the waters are abated. Here's the ark sitting on the mountain. You know, actually, it's sitting between. It's not sitting on Mount Ararat. It's really sitting between the mountains.
Okay.
See, just like, draw a line, just like this cloud here sat between two archangels. Mm-hmm. You understand? Okay. Now, I went through all of that so that I can get to this part and directly address this question. Get the textbook, volume 4, page 20.
At the top?
All the way down at the bottom.
That little paragraph? Volume 4 at the page 20 at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
It was by the flood that Yahweh had cast Satan and his host out of mankind and destroyed Satan's earthly antediluvian kingdom built by Cain without a divine pattern and divine specifications. See City of Enoch in the land of Nod. Leaving Satan after the flood without residence in mankind. And Yahweh said unto Satan, "Whence cometh thou?" And he answered.
Go ahead.
You're
just breaking up.
And he answered, "From going to and fro in the earth and walking up and down in it, and seeking rest findeth none. Then he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out, that is in man. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh himself 7 other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first."
Okay.
Even so,
go ahead.
Even so it shall it be also unto this wicked generation.
Okay, let's just pause for a moment. Okay, now, this is the part that addresses the question, because the question was, how come Satan is asked to get together? You know, the point is, he's not asked to get together. He just showed up.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just read the scripture, Job. Job 1 and 6. Job 1 and 6.
Job 1 and 6. Now there was a day when the sons of Elohim came to present themselves before Yahweh, and Satan came also among them.
And Satan came also. He didn't say he was invited. He just came. Now the question is, where did he come to? Because we just showed you he was kicked out of here.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
See, that's the question. Where did he come to? Let me try this. Maybe it might help. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Now. Okay. He's up here as in the angelic creation, all right? And he's cast out. All right, he's cast out. And he's down here into the earth, all right? But he wants to come back, but he can't come back because there's a veil here. He was kicked out of there. So he's rebuffed and he comes back down. Okay? So this part he cannot access. This part he can. So can as well as this part. Now we already said that there was three heavens. All right? Space, atmosphere. Eternity, or spirit law, let's say. It does say in the scripture that Satan, if anybody can find that he's the prince of the power of the air. Mm-hmm. Well, that means he can occupy this part. See, he can occupy, he can come into the holy place, so to speak. And he's already down here in the court roundabout. Okay? So these two compartments he can access. Elohim is universal. Okay? However, to give it, see now, what the textbook is showing, what we just read here, that this was after, let's see, what was it? It says, it was by the flood that Yahweh had cast Satan and his host out of mankind. How did that happen? By a flood. Here we are. Here's Satan and his host being cast out of mankind. How? Mankind is drowning. So they're cast out. And like this raven, they're going to and fro.
Right.
And then we read about how the ark settled on the mountains of Ararat and the waters dry. And there was a time, Noah and his family were still in the ark, but the earth was dry. So you got these spirits roaming around on the dry ground, seeking whom they may devour. Right. But nobody's come out of the ark yet.
Right.
You see? See, that's what it's telling you here in the textbook.
Do you want that scripture about power of the air?
Yeah, read that just right quick. Where you at? I thought you just had it.
I do.
Okay.
Ephesians 2:2. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world,
mm-hmm.
according to the prince of the power of the air.
The prince of the power of the air. What do you mean? He can occupy the holy place. He can't come up here.
Right.
But he can come here.
That's right.
Ain't sure dwelling down here.
For sure.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because if he's in the holy place, then he's standing where he ought not.
Right.
Got it?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, let's show you an example of that. Zechariah. I'm thinking the second chapter. Let's show. Third chapter.
Three.
What? Yes.
The beginning?
Yes.
Zechariah 3:1.
Mm-hmm.
And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing mm-hmm. before the angel of Yahweh.
Here it is right. Look, we got it right here. Here's the high, Joshua, the high priest. There was a high priest named Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Oh.
And he's standing here. And he's standing before Yahweh. And this is where he's at. He's at the altar of incense. All right?
Mm-hmm.
So he's standing before the angel of Yahweh.
Right.
But what?
And Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him.
In the holy place. Standing right there.
That's right.
To accuse him. He his angel. But Satan, he's standing right there. Prince of the power of the air.
Yeah.
But read.
And Yahweh said unto Satan, Yahweh rebuke thee, O Satan. Even Yahweh that has chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garment and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with the change of garment, raiment. And I said, let them set a fair mite upon his head. So they set a fair mite upon his head and clothed him with the garment. And the angel of Yahweh stood by.
So his clean garments. See, what are you talking about? See, he's a type and shadow. Talking about this high priest whose name was Joshua. He's a type and shadow of this high priest whose name was Yahshua. And said what? Take away his filthy garments. What do you mean? Well, Yahshua, see, he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. Filthy garments.
Right.
All right. Take away those filthy garments and give him a clean garment.
Right.
See, that doesn't say he's resurrected. See, as a life-giving spirit or a quickening spirit. Clean garments. And a clean mitre. That's the word. That's how you pronounce that.
Right.
A mitre. See, you see what I mean? But yet, Lucifer was standing right there. Right there to resist. He's supposed to do that.
Yep, that's his job.
He's a worthy adversary.
That's his job.
Okay? Now, let's go back to the textbook. Where she left off page 21. It's from going up and down, to and fro in the earth, walking up and down in it. It's that little part.
21. The last state was worked. Even so shall it be unto this wicked generation.
No, go back up. Because we're going to and fro in the earth and walking up and down in it. There's a line. That's the third line from the top.
Okay. And seeking rest, finding none. Then he said, I will return into my house from whence I came out, that is, in man. And
You missed the one line I want you to read. From going to and fro in the earth.
From going to and fro in the earth and walking up and down in it. And Satan walking to and fro in the earth through dry places. See dry earth after the flood and seeking.
That's what we read. We read that part. See, that's the part that he's talking about. Read.
And seeking rest findeth none. Then he said, I will return into my house from whence I came out, that is in man. And when he is come, he findeth empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of the man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also until this wicked generation. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out.
Okay, now just hold it right there. Now, it says the last state of that man, in other words, when Noah and his family came out and they began to repopulate the earth, see, then that's when Lucifer said, well, I'm going to go back into.
Right.
22. See, now I'm going to go back and cut it back into the man. And the last state of the man will be worse than the first. That's what happened. They built the Tower of Babel.
Yeah.
The last state of that man was worse than the first. Because Nimrod came along. Nimrod was a pickle. Now, you thought Cain was something. Man. Nimrod was ruthless. But the people worshipped him. See. Yes.
Now, he says he took seven more wickeder than they were. That implies that they're worse now. The demons?
Yeah, they're just Well, yeah, I mean, you know, as opposed to one, you know, then you got to deal with eight.
Yeah, really.
You know? I mean, just look at it from a natural standpoint. You might can handle somebody one-on-one, but you got eight somebody people on you, unless you Bruce Lee or somebody, you know. I'm just saying, they took over the house, and they just, you know how people are, you know. They take over somebody's career. It ain't there, so they just trash it. Just trash. You just go buck wild. You know, I don't, you know, eat everything. Just do whatever, you know. So it's more wicked than themselves. See, in other words, it's a principle that repeats itself. I think we did that one session where it talked about, where we showed about with Yahshua. When Yahshua, during the last week before his crucifixion, he came into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. All right, and the people spread palm leaves, and they said, "Hosanna, Hosanna!"
Yeah.
See, blessed is he who cometh in the name of Yahweh. Now the reason why they did that, because a lot of those people, see, Yahshua healed them,
right.
And he and his disciples through the Spirit healed them. In some cases, he fed them.
Mm-hmm.
So they remember. They say, "Oh, you know." In other words, the way Dr. Kinley explained it, when Yahshua sent them out, especially here. After this event, he sent them out 70, two by two, to preach. And they healed the sick, you know, raised the, you know, they did all kind of miracles, cast out demons. They did all of that. So the people's houses were clean, swept, and garnished. So then, when Joshua came to the city, they spread palm leaves, Hosanna, Hosanna. But then a few days later, the same people, see, was there screaming, crucify him, crucify him. Well, what happened? See, their houses were clean, swept, and garnished, but they didn't receive the Holy Spirit. So the Sanhedrin Council, when they confronted Pilate, and Pilate asked, who should I release unto you, Barabbas or Yahshua of Nazareth? And so the Sanhedrin Council was going through the crowd talking about, Barabbas, Barabbas. Barabbas, 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 you know, they were egging them on, you know. In other words, they were reincarnating back into
right.
them and the last state of the people, because they at the end,
right.
See, a week before, they were saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, unto Yahweh, you know, blessed is he who come in the name of Yahweh. Then the same people are saying, crucify him, crucify him.
That's worse.
The last state, worse than the first.
Mm-hmm.
See, it's principle, okay? Let's finish reading that.
And after the sup, Satan entered into him, Judas Iscariot. Then said Yahshua unto him, that thou doest, do it quickly. Judas, with Satan incarnated within him, after negotiating with the Sanhedrin council, or his, Satan's angels, betrayed Yahshua the Messiah for 30 pieces of silver, committed suicide, releasing Satan from that physical body. According to Paul in Ephesians, this is the same spirit that now, in this present age, worketh within the children of disobedience, which we must locate and expose by the satanic number 666.
Okay. All right. Go back to Job. Let's pick up on a couple of things there.
Yeah, where was this?
Starting at the 6.
Just read it over. 1 and 6.
Oh, 1 and 6? Now there was a day when the sons of Elohim came to present themselves before Yahweh, and Satan came also among them. And Yahweh said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered Yahweh and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And Yahweh said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth Elohim and escheweth evil?
Okay. Now, hold on. Now, read on a little more.
Then Satan answered Yahweh and said, does Job fear Elohim for naught? Hast not thou made an hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land.
Okay, good enough. All right. Now, first of all, you have to understand that this is in the realm of eternity, okay? So time begins and ends in the realm of eternity. See, and this means nothing, see, as far as Yahweh's concerned, all right? And so, and he's look, and he's talking to Lucifer. He said, you didn't went out, because we told you, because he burnt up all the grass. All right, burnt up all the grass, but he didn't burn this one. He didn't burn Job. Why? Because there was a hedge around him. And see, it was drawn out for a reason, because he was for a purpose. Okay? And so Satan, he didn't ravished, because see, here he is, because see, Job existed in the same dispensation as Abraham. Okay, now I don't know if he knew Abraham, but the scriptures don't intimate that. But I do know that he was before Moses and before the Exodus. So it would have to be in this dispensation. Okay? Because also another thing is you don't see the name Yahweh in the book of Job either. That's another indicator. Mm. You don't see that the name Yahweh is not in the book of Job, but Elohim is, but not Yahweh. So that should tell you that he was before Moses, because Moses was the first one whom Yahweh revealed the name to. Okay?
It's in this one.
Huh?
It's in this one.
Oh, is it?
Yep.
Which, hold on. Let me look at this. Let me look, because that's probably A.B. Trainer.
Yeah.
That's A.B. Trainer.
Yeah, it is.
What's it saying? Let's see. Wait. Yeah.
There's one time.
Okay, just one. Okay, just one. Okay. What's it say in the King James 1:12?
Oh, 1:12.
Right there. But he used Elohim.
And Yahweh said.
No. What does it say in the King James?
And the Lord said.
Oh, okay. Okay. Then I'm mistaken. But they, whoever wrote Job, inserted Yahweh in there. But the truth is, he's before Moses. Based on the research, that's the point I'm trying to make.
Okay,
so I misspoke on the Yahweh thing.
Okay.
It's not impossible.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's. I hope that answers the question somewhat as far as where this happened at, and this is in eternity, but the Yahweh is ever present. He says, the sons of Yahweh assemble wherever. Because see, the sons of Yahweh we got here the sons of Yahweh in the holy place. I'm talking about the children of Israel. They assembled there in the holy place. So it's not impossible. Okay. So as far as that is concerned with Job, it's in the textbook. We just showed you where that is in the textbook and how Dr. Kinley is using that to draw an example of a principle of they were cast out and they incarnated in man, and then they were cast out again through the flood. And it's just the same principle, you know, repeating, and then they reincarnate in man, and the last state of the man is worse than the first. And it's the same thing that's happening, it's the same that is happening now. Just like here, let's get Revelations 20 and 1.
Would the sons be the prophets?
I'm sorry?
Would the sons be the prophets?
What do you mean by that? The sons of Yahweh gathered together, and
Satan came also.
Yeah.
See, that's a good question. It could have been the sons of prophets. It could have been angels. It just says the sons of Elohim. Now, it's just a matter of what context it is. If you say they're angels, angels are on the veils, and also in the scriptures it says angels. See, this is a ladder. And so angels ascending and descending on the veil, so they got full range. Mm-hmm. Talking about the angels, talking about the righteous angels. But now demons, See, this is their path. See, see, their path is the court roundabout, which is destruction. See, because see, they got cast out. They want to try to escape it, but they can't. There's a veil, and they're rebuffed, and they're just cast. They're just reserved in chains of darkness. But while they're here, and we're here, you know, they have access to the flesh. So they use the flesh as much as they can, like blades of grass. Where are we at?
Revelations 20.
Yes.
And 1.
Yes.
And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. And cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years should be fulfilled. After that, he must be loosed a little season.
All right. Now, that's here. An angel coming down. See, that is Joshua. Because the key, having the key to the bottomless pit. The key is the pattern. Right. Look. The key is the pattern. If you're here, then you got the keys, then you have access to the whole building. Put it like that. You know, like, you know, if you're the night watchman or something, you know, you got all these whole sets of keys. You got, you know, everybody else is gone. You may not own the building. You just watch it, but actually you're the man, because you got keys to everything.
Right. What is the bottomless pit?
The bottomless pit is space.
Oh.
Space, atmosphere, eternity. Space, that's the bottomless pit. Space doesn't have a bottom. I mean, has anybody found an end to space yet?
No, it doesn't have a top either.
See? It's the bottomless pit. And you're in it.
Right.
You're on the earth, you're in it.
Right.
You're in the bottomless pit.
Surprise!
See? The bottomless pit. And there's an angel down, because you read in Revelation, there's an angel at the bottomless pit. See? There's an angel down there, and he's a destroyer. See? Now, Yahshua, okay, when Yahshua resurrected, he's the one with the key, and he had a great chain in his hand. The great chain are these dispensations, because they are linked together like a chain. Mm-hmm. And these are the chains that bind the mystery of iniquity. As he's coming down through each dispensation, each link is being added until we get to the last. And when that is added, and then that's when here, secure and booted into the lake of fire. These are the links. And seeing Yahshua has that chain and laid hold on him and bound him for 1,000 years. What does that mean? That means this. You know, I might be able to read it if I remember right. I'm sorry?
Is he
going to
use the same devil?
Well, you know, there is a lecture where Dr. Kinley said that Satan, he'll be destroyed, no doubt. Destroyed, but Yahweh can reconstitute anything.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And for what I understand, the way Dr. Kinley explained it, that the devil, he'll be rewarded for his good job. You know, not resurrected or saved. He'll just be reconstituted to do the same job again. Yeah, I say, well, you're so good. At this. I'm going to bring you back. Come back next. You know, like, you know, somebody do a good job. I say, man, you did some good. Boy, why don't you come on back next week? Man, I got some work for you.
That's funny.
Okay. I want you to get the pink pamphlet. Get the pink pamphlet, which is otherwise known as "The Clergy Has Ignorantly Called Yahshua the Messiah a Liar in Saying That He Instituted Rather Than Fulfilled Carnal Ordinances." Okay?
Okay.
I want you to get the pink pamphlet, and I want you to turn to page 30.
Paragraph?
The last paragraph.
Page 30, the pamphlet. The clergy has ignorantly called Yahshua the Messiah a liar. However, these were not all of them that were liberated from the bondage of captivity of sin and death. The Apostle John wrote, "And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that he must be loosed a little season. And I saw thrones, and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Yahshua, and for the word of Yahweh, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received the mark up on their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with the Messiah 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection." The Apostle John is speaking of the day of the resurrection of Yahshua, the Messiah, from the grave. "Then, as the first fruits of them that slept arose from the grave first, never to die again." Again, Judas's betrayer never resurrected. "And after his resurrection, many of the sons of Yahweh, from Adam down to the Messiah, who had died in the faith and looked forward to the promised Redeemer, arose from the grave. This is a vision. And went into fulfillment into Jerusalem. This was done in fulfillment of the law pertaining to the liberation of the slaves from bondage and the returning of every man's possession on the Day of Atonement in the year of Jubilee, and in fulfillment of Israel's prophecy, and Yahshua should free the captives from their prisons, and also of Ezekiel's prophecy pertaining to the laying on of sinews of flesh upon the dry bones in the valley and the instilling of breath into them. Therefore, all of the sons of Yahweh who arose from the dead after Messiah's resurrection have been freed from the bondage of death and liberated from the grave, lived and reigned with the Messiah at all that day." One day equals 1,000 years. "While Judas lay out in the graveyard and Sanhedrin council were gathered together, trying to devise a lie to tell the people regarding Yahshua's resurrection. Thus, those that rose after the Messiah's resurrection were alive forevermore. But the rest of the dead, the disciples and others of the Jews who had not yet received the Holy Spirit, did not live until the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was poured out on them, some 50 days after Yahshua's resurrection. This resurrection of the dead is still going on right down to the present time, for as those who are walking around on the earth plane, apparently alive but dead in their sins, receive the understanding of Yahshua the Messiah according to the law and prophets, they are resurrected to walk into a newness of life."
Okay, that's good enough. All right, now we read the part there where it said that when Yahshua resurrected, see, Judas was in the graveyard, and the Sanhedrin council, they sequestered themselves in the temple that day when Yahshua resurrected, and all those that resurrected with him, trying to devise a lie for this.
Yeah.
See, they all were in the temple. In other words, they were bound in there for that one day, which is the same as 1,000 years.
Right.
But when they came out, let's go back to the scripture, Revelations 20. You read part of it. Go down, I think, to 6, Revelation 20 and 6.
Revelations 20 and 6. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such part in the first resurrection, on such the second death hath no power. But they shall be priests of Elohim and of the Messiah, and shall reign with him mm-hmm. 1,000 years.
So that's here. Mm. That's here they are. Here's Yahshua, and here they are. They walked into Jerusalem, and they reigned with Yahshua for 1,000 years. See that day right there. Okay, continue reading.
And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea.
So now when they shall be loosed from the prison, in other words, they came out the next day. Talking about the Sanhedrin. They came out the next day. And they said, you know, well, his disciples came and stole the body away. Mm. And they've been lying ever since. And that was those demons incarnated in the Sanhedrin Council. And them demons have been lying ever since. Okay? Been lying ever since. All right, now, look how much time we got. I hope I answered the question.
It looks like it according to the response on YouTube.
Yeah, I hope that answered the question. Because I know, because folks, because I asked it myself once. I mean, like, okay, where is this happening at, you know? But you have to use the scriptures and the pattern to kind of understand the chain of events that's happening, that's coming down, all right? Because we got as far as here, and see, and these guys here, they look here. The satanic foundation of the Tower of Babel, just a satanic foundation. In other words, they were incarnated. See, as men multiplied, they incarnated in man, right. and the imagination, you know, just went off the scale. We went through this the other week when we went through about the fourth generation, the iniquity of the fourth generation. This was the fourth. This was the iniquity that Yahweh visited upon the fourth generation of mankind. See, they were here. This is the satanic foundation, and see, satanic immersion, which is psychological. What does that mean? It just simply means they were incarnated. That's all that means. They were incarnated with that. And saying, look, and they were building, and they were building their own little tower, mm-hmm. trying to reach the heavens. A throne, really, for Nimrod. That's really what it was. And then here, you have the spirit law, see, the spoken word, see, like a cloud. The way Dr. Kinley explained it, said it was like a heavy mist that descended on them and confused their tongues. And then they went out. Human government. And then they went out. We got it here. And they went out hither and thither, seeking whom they may devour, going to and fro. It's the same thing, because that's what happened after the Tower of Babel. What did they do? They were scattered. Or what? They went to and fro. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing. See, going to and fro, you know, incarnating, being worse. Yeah. And the last state of man was worse than the last state of man was worse than the first. We're living in the last state of man, which is worse than the first. The conglomeration of all these things coming down. Mm-hmm. See. And Satan's kingdom is divided against itself. Yeah. See, I used to think, you know, maybe at one time there might be some sort of unity that they would get together and, you know, join forces and you know, but I don't see it. I don't see it. It's like the old saying, you know, there's no honor among thieves, mm-hmm. right? You know, everybody wants to be top dog. You know, even in like a gang or the mafias, you know, I got to be the boss. I pay the cost to be the boss, you know? And people sometimes will pay a heavy price just to be the boss, just to wear the white suit, so to speak, or the robe or the crown, you know, or something, you know, whatever symbol of authority you may have. you know. See.
That kind of showed us, because when we read that when Judas went to the Pharisees or to offer up Yahshua, it said that the adversary incarnated in Judas went to his angels, to conspire against him.
Yeah, well, we read that the other day about diseases. Because, see, the devil was in Peter. And then, it's like an old joke, in fact, it was so funny because I was watching, I just happened to be channeling something, and I came across the Little Rascals the other day, and Stymie was funny, and Stymie, they was trying to get him to do something, and Stymie was like saying, devil, get thee behind me, but don't push. But that's what Joshua told Peter when Peter, when he was telling them, I said, "Look, it's got to come a time. I got to get on this cross." Mm-hmm. And Peter, not understanding, he's like, Satan is in him, see, because Satan knows that the last thing he wants to see is, is the redemption of mankind. He said, "No, this will never happen to you." And Joshua said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." And so Satan left Peter. And they got into Judas Iscariot, or like we was reading with the diseases, he had infected Peter.
Right.
And then Peter, it turned and left Peter and infected Judas. See? And the last state of Judas was worse than the first.
Right.
Even though he was the bag man and all, and he was out. And look, Judas was out here. He was with the 70 chosen, 2x2. He was doing everything they all were doing. He was casting out demons. He was healing the sick, making the blind to see, the deaf to hear. He was doing all of that. And he saw Yahshua for 3.5 years, performing everything. He saw Yahshua perform all these ordinances. See, what is that? I think it's Acts, first chapter. See, Satan is an evil angelic creature, no doubt. We can show it up on the board, but he has a carnal mind.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't understand spiritual things, because technically he's bruised in the head.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about Lucifer. Despite the fact that he incarnates in the flesh and he's got powers and stuff too, but he's as carnal as this law. He's carnal, and he has to operate through the flesh. It's Acts, the first chapter. I know. I just need to find the.
Acts 1 and 16.
I'll start with 15, just to get a
15. Predicate. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said,
mm-hmm.
The number of names together are about 120. Men and brethren, the scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Yahshua. For he was numbered with us and had obtained part of this ministry.
Okay, now, here's Peter. He doesn't have, this is before Pentecost, so he doesn't have the Holy Spirit, but he's been 3.5 years with this man. And for 3.5 years with this man, they asked him, what was he doing? They said, Yahshua, why are we going here? And you know what Yahshua would say to them? I'm fulfilling.
Mm.
Yahshua, why are you doing that? I'm fulfilling. Yahshua, why are you doing this thing? I'm fulfilling. Everything he did, when they asked him questions, he told them, I said, look, I'm fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
This scripture needs to be fulfilled. I'm fulfilling. That's what he kept telling them for 3.5 years. So now here we are with Peter, even though he ain't got the Holy Spirit, but after 3.5 years, it's been hammered in his head that, that many brethren, this scripture must needs be fulfilled. Because, he's with him for 3.5 years. Okay? And he talks about Judas, see? And Judas was picked just like all the other disciples were. He didn't put an application in or anything. Yahshua picked him just like he picked them all. Okay. Continue reading.
18. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and all his bowels gushed out.
Mm-hmm.
And it was known unto all the dwellers at Jerusalem, insomuch as that field is called in their proper tongue, Esildama, that is to say, the field of blood.
Mm-hmm.
For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take. Wherefore, if these men which have companied with us all the time that the Yahweh Elohim went in and out among us, Yahshua the Messiah went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John unto the same day that he was taken up from us, must one be ordained to be a witness with us of his resurrection. And they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, Thou, Master, which knoweth the hearts of all men, show whither these two thou hast chosen,
mm-hmm.
that he may take part in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles.
Okay. Now, Peter knew enough to say, okay, look, Judas, you know, whom by transgression fell, you know, he was numbered with us. So it must needs, he has to be replaced. It's got to be 12 of us. They understood that. What they didn't understand was right. It was not up to them right. to pick the replacement.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because they weren't the ones who picked the apostles in the first place.
Yeah.
They didn't pick themselves into the group. You know, it was Yahshua that chose them. So likewise, Yahshua has to choose the replacement. See, and that real replacement was Saul of Tarsus.
Mm-hmm.
That's who replaced Judas. See, okay? But the point I wanted to make was Judas hung himself before Yahshua got out here on the cross. And Satan incarnated in Judas did not see the conclusion. He saw Yahshua, talking about Satan and Yahshua and Judas, saw Yahshua perform all these carnal ordinances, sacrifices, baptism, Passover. He saw him perform all these things, see, but he did not see the end or the conclusion of it.
Mm-hmm.
See, he didn't understand that. So therefore, those spirits incarnated in the man, see, they don't understand this New Testament. They can't conceive of it. This they understand. Why? Because this law was created specifically to deal with the flesh.
Right.
And they were told up here in the garden, the serpent, it says, on thy belly shalt thou crawl, and dust will you eat all the days of your life. Meaning what? Here you're going to incarnate in the flesh. You're the Leviathan. See, rising up out of the sea of men. Until this rock comes, or until the Ancient of Days come. See, kingdom of Satan abolished, kingdom of Yahshua restored. How does that happen? Got to destroy it. See, what are you talking about? Get some bombs and planes and go? No. It's from within. From within. Destroy his kingdom from within. See? That's what has to come down. So this can be made manifested. To see who you really are. Because this is who you really are. See, this is who you this is what we all did. We all absorbed everything from the world from day one. We're almost done. Thank you. Any questions?
Oh, Alan just said, yes, you did answer the question. He said, thank you. And he got his answer. He said, second heaven. Wow.
Not third heaven.
Okay. First heaven, second heaven,
third heaven. Yeah.
See, space, atmosphere, eternity. See,
I think what you really got him when you said standing in the holy place where he ought not.
He ought, here, look here.
Yeah.
He is here. Standing in the holy place where he ought, They're supposed to be there. Why was that guy standing there? He was standing at his right hand. That's what the scripture said in Zechariah.
That's right.
To oppose him. In other words, to distract him, because he was having an A and B conversation with this angel, and Satan tried to see his way into this. Or I can even say it like this: they had Joshua and his angel had an A and A conversation. He could have just turned to Satan and said, "Hey, look, how you be in this?" You know.
Yeah.
But that's his job.
Right.
That's his job to do that. That's his job. To do that, that's why do you think you're on this path? The way, the truth, the light, and then all these things are, they're there. He's an adversary. They're there to distract you, but you have an advocate who is Yahshua.
Right.
That if you stay, if you keep your eyes on him,
right,
he will navigate you through this. See, in all manners of life, because he is the one, he's the one that's doing everything.
That's right.
He's the one man show. And he's incorporated in everything. See, the thing is, and in you, that's the most important thing to realize. The power latent in man. See, one of our aims is about the powers latent in man. See, the power latent in man is not the Holy Spirit. That's not latent in anything, because the Holy Spirit and the law of the Spirit are one and the same. And that is ever present. The problem is, you're not. Mm-hmm. You're not cognizant of it. You're not conscious of it. Dr. Kinley said it best. I am Yahweh.
That's right.
Yeah, and so are you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm conscious of it, but you may not be.
Mm-hmm.
But that's why he started this class.
Mm-hmm.
So that hopefully you come in here and we can rip the veils off. So that flash of the Shekinah, you know, will shine in your heart and mind. And you will awaken to the fact of who you really are. See yourself as you really are, which is a true son of Yahweh, who is. And when you recognize that, that is the resurrected Yahshua the Messiah in you. Okay? Thank you for your time and patience. Be safe. Be healthy. Be in Yahshua, who truly is your only hope of glory. Hallelujah.
Okay, that concludes tonight's workshop. Are there any announcements?
I'll be gone for mostly the next month.
Okay, Ken Way will be gone for most of next month. Also, Dr. Will Williams will be gone too. He's going to Florida. He'll be driving out there. He'll be gone for about 3 weeks too, right?
What?
About 3 weeks. Okay. We'll be here to cover it. So, now, okay. And good evening to everybody that's listening in, those in Mexico and out here in the United States. Okay, we have classes here Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays 7:30, 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser, our treasurer. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah.